Panorama TV presents How'd They Do That, where we explore the world of professional photographers and share their techniques with you. Here's your host, Mark Wallace.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to this week's episode of How'd They Do That. Today, we're joined by Louisa J. Curtis. She is a creative consultant for photographers. She does all kinds of things. In addition to that, she's a marketing and business services expert. She also does event planning and production, and she also is a panel moderator and a speaker at all kinds of photography events. So welcome to the show, Louisa.
Thank you very much, Mark. It's my pleasure to be here.
Well, let's start out by asking a very simple question, and that is, help us understand what a creative consultant does. How can you help out photographers? Explain that for us.
Sure. Well, I can help photographers, as other consultants do, in many, many ways. And I like to treat my clients differently, so each one is a new case, and therefore I'm going to help them with whatever it is that is particular to their needs. A lot of the time, it's going to be focused around their marketing and how best they should be presenting their work. But with some people, it might be where we start just by looking at the work. Sometimes a photographer needs some direction in really deciding what it is they're best at or which markets they should be promoting to.
And what kind of photographers are you talking to? Are these emerging professional photographers, people that have been in the business for a while? What's your normal client?
Actually, a range. I do have emerging photographers that come to me and students also that are just coming out of school. And with them, it's about helping them understand that they are now entering into a business, if they're serious, that it's not just taking pictures for fun, and there are certain steps they need to take. Some photographers have been in business for longer, and maybe they've hit the wall and they need to reevaluate who they are as an artist and the markets that they want to promote to. But there's a real range, to be honest with you, of photographers that I deal with. And I also have worked with some illustrators as well, because again, they're artists and they're looking to promote themselves.
Okay, well, we have all kinds of questions for you, and I'm sure that these are the kind of questions you get from a lot of photographers. The first question is, you've been in this business for a number of years. How has social media changed the business of photography?
Well, I think social media has not only changed the business of photography, it's changed the whole world we live in, because the younger generation is now communicating through Facebook, through Twitter, and LinkedIn. So you have a younger generation that are very comfortable with this because that's how they grew up. And then you have people like myself who didn't grow up with social media and are having to integrate that into what we already know. I think it has change the industry into making it perhaps broader, and it's making it harder for photographers to really sift through and identify their markets. On the downside, I think it can distract photographers. Too much social networking, personal, this is my personal opinion, means that they're not actually taking enough pictures.
Yeah, I can totally identify with that issue. Because we have so much social networking out there. Well, let me ask you another question that's closely related to that, and it seems like the news is everybody needs a blog on their website. You see that every day. But not every single photographer is a good writer. What is your recommendation for blogs on websites?
Don't do a blog unless you really want to. I think the danger of a lot of these trends is that, as you said, somebody says, we've got to have a blog now, so all of a sudden everybody has a blog. I think the blog is a place for a photographer to express themselves more personally, more creatively. Some of the buyers that I speak to do enjoy reading photographers' blogs. Having said that, it can also work against you. In an extreme instance, supposing you are a commercial photographer and then you blog about your personal work, which is a little edgy and perhaps a little too racy for some of your clients, and they see that, they're going to be a little perhaps put off with working with you. So you have to make sure that what you're blogging about supports the commercial vision. And again, don't do it unless you really want to. I came up with this idea the other day. If you compare marketing to a salad bar, I know it sounds a bit strange, but if you go in and you just have a salad that's made of lettuce, it's pretty boring. but you need to add in all these other ingredients. Not everyone is going to take every single ingredient from the salad bar. So somebody might have chickpeas and another person might have cranberries. So whatever works for your particular marketing. So some people definitely do well with a blog. Others are not going to. The same with the Facebook or the LinkedIn or even a newsletter. I think it's a way of getting some of your personality out into the world, but it needs to complement what you're doing commercially.
Well, speaking of doing things commercially, the million-dollar question is, who is hiring photographers today? Can you give us some insight on that?
Well, that's a good question. Obviously, there are photographers working out there, but it is harder and harder, and you are up against a lot of competition. I think part of the problem in the industry is that the product has been devalued through digital, through the internet, and having the availability of photography so massive now. But people are still using photographs. Even if it's web usage, they still need photographs. So I think that if your passion is truly about taking photographs, then you will find a market for it. There are definitely trends. People get scared in a recession and they might not be as willing to hire new photographers. They may stick with the ones they know, but they do like to experiment when they feel they've got the budget.
What advice do you have for photographers who are building their portfolios or maybe revamping their portfolios? What are the strategies for that?
Well, I think the first thing, interestingly, is just to identify where their strengths are in the portfolio. And often when I consult with people, it's really interesting how they show me stuff and then right towards the end of the session, they suddenly go, oh, and I've got this as well. And that's usually the best work. Somehow they keep some of the best things hidden. So in the beginning, it's really about identifying what the best work is and what work does the photographer really enjoy shooting. If they're shooting weddings and they don't like it, then they're not doing a good job. They're not doing probably their best work and they're doing a disservice to the bride. So a wedding photographer needs to be passionate, just like a portrait photographer or a photojournalist or an advertising. You need to really love what you do. And when you are showing imagery that reflects your passion, then that is going to come through the work. So it's identifying that work that makes your heart sing that will therefore make, hopefully, the client's heart sing.
All right. So let's say we have a photographer. They've talked to you. They've got some consulting. Their portfolio is in pretty darn good shape. The research is in place. Do you have some strategies for self-promotion that these photographers can use?
Yeah, well, the first thing I would do is ask them everything that they've done up until this point and what the results have been. Sometimes they've done emails, but they've only done maybe three, or maybe they didn't even check the results. The whole point of doing emails is to check how many people are clicking through to your website or even reading your newsletter or your blog. So stats and checking who's doing what is very important. But I think it is, again, you've got to be careful about what you pick and choose. And each photographer, as I sound like a broken record now, but everyone is different. So there's never one answer that covers everybody. But with somebody who's got already a pretty good portfolio, then we really would delve into what markets have they perhaps not tapped into yet. Or maybe the work needs to be split up. I had a client, for instance, who had been selling a lot of his work as stock, but he really wanted to up the ante and focus on the fine artwork. So for him, we had two separate websites where he really was clear that this was two different marketplaces. And he's been doing very well when we really made it, he was very clear and we really implemented that. Two different websites, two different bodies of work.
Okay, well, there's some great advice for self-promotion. Another question that we want to ask you is how important SEO is, search engine optimization to websites. Is that something that photographers really need to pay attention to?
SEO is very, very important because obviously you want your website to come up first in a Google search, and a lot of buyers are in a rush and they're going to use things like Google search to find you. They may not go to a portfolio website and spend a lot of time. You may not be an expert in this, but I've always said if you're not an expert, in a certain area of your business, then you get help with that. SEO is very important along with your blog, and this is the reason why a lot of people have chosen to do a blog, because the crawlers will pick up the links from a blog, and therefore you'll come up again higher in these search rankings. But the search engine optimization is extremely important.
Well, let's talk about another topic that we hear a lot about, and that is education. There are a lot of very successful photographers that are self-taught. There are people that have learned through going to photography workshops. How important is it these days for photographers to go to an accredited photography school? Is that something that's required, or can you learn from assisting? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think that you can certainly go to school, but you don't have to be a successful photographer. There are instances of people that have not gone to school. I think for anyone, education is extremely important, no matter what profession you're going into. But if you're someone that has decided that you don't want to necessarily learn in a school environment, but you want to just get your hands dirty and be an assistant, then I think it is an extremely valuable way to really learn your craft. And I remember myself taking some photography classes a few years ago, and the message was very clear. You've either got to do a full-time course, or you've got to jump out and assist. And at least with assisting, you're learning from people that are already in the business. So I think assisting is really, really crucial, because you're not just learning classroom photography, you're out in the real world. I remember a client who told me that he had worked with a photographer in Miami in the very beginning. And the photographer told me what he loved about this assistant was he never asked him how to take a photograph. He asked him, how do I talk to a client? How do I deal with the business? How do I promote myself? He asked all of those things that often don't get answered in the school classroom. And so I think it is really important that you have to learn these other facets to photography business.
Yeah, I totally agree. I go to a lot of college campuses and talk to students, and I'm amazed at how much the schools are not teaching. And so I totally agree about the assisting. Well, we're actually out of time, so thank you very much for joining us today, Louisa. It's been great having you on the show.
Thank you so much, Mark. It was my pleasure.
Well, remember, if you want to see more of Louisa's work and find out about what she does, you can check out her website. It's chatterboxenterprises.com. She's got a wonderful newsletter that you can sign up for on her website to find out all kinds of interesting things and get more advice, like the kind of advice you heard on our show today. And remember, you can always go to the Adorama Learning Center to see all kinds of things about photography and every single episode that we've ever done on how they do that. So please visit and subscribe to the show so you don't miss a single episode. Well, thanks for joining me this week. I'll see you again next week.
This episode is brought to you by Adorama TV. Visit the Adorama Learning Center, where you'll find photography tips and techniques, links to the gear used in this episode, and related videos. For all the latest photography, video, and computer gear, visit Adorama.com. And the next time you're in New York City, visit our store located on 18th Street between 5th and 6th Avenue.